What's known about you? Every click, every swipe, every photo, I mean everything. We're almost to the end of the decade where we've gone as humans from being kind of mysterious to almost completely known. And what that means is starting to seep in. I'm a data artist. And I make work about the future of data about you. And before you go, oh God, I just want to hide. No. I'm here today, and I'm going to basically talk you through this idea that I think data is going to turn upside down. It's going to be completely different. It's just not going to go the way you expect. I actually think data is going to turn out to be irresistible. I actually want my data. You know, I asked myself that question, you know, what's known about me? And a couple years ago, I started actually making a list. People that know me, like a list, it's very natural. I started making a list, and it was like, all right, credit cards, you know, I Googled myself, what's known, I thought about loyalty programs, you know, you start going, what apps do I use? I had this watch that kept track of my skin temperature. You know, and the list got really long, and you know, every couple days I'd think of something else. I realized Amazon knows how fast I read because of my Kindle. Amazon knows if I cheat and look at the end of a mystery book. They know how many books I've never finished. You know, on one hand I thought, okay, this is kind of, I mean, it was kind of an interesting list, more complex than I can even remember, maybe even more than I'm willing to admit. You know, on the other hand, I'm going, all right, what's going to happen with all this data? How's this going to turn out? What's going to happen with all of it in the future? You know, I've always been really curious about the future. You know, when I was a kid, I was the tallest one in the class. You can see me in the back row. And I couldn't wait to grow up. Maybe it was because, you know, I wanted to jump forward into my actual size. But I can remember as a kid, I hated being tall. You know, it's how people look at me now, and it's like, what? Everything bad that happened to me as a kid, I attributed to being tall. When I was 13, I grew 6 inches that year. Yeah, exactly. And it was like the person grew faster than the person inside. It just didn't fit. I didn't fit in. Somehow I think I thought, if I could see the future, I could know. What's this going to be like? You know, this whole thing about seeing the future, I do think we leave clues for ourselves. When I was in college, I switched majors a whole bunch of times. I've lived in different cities. I've had a whole bunch of different jobs. You know, after 20 years in the tech industry, I, you know, finally ended up running big organizations for computer companies, you know, and always working on future products. Anyway, after 20 years, I switched again. It was a really big switch. I quit my job, and I went back to art school. And when I graduated from school, I started making artwork, started making work about time. And it felt like something had changed. Time had become not just these little bits, it was like time had become fragmented. You know what I'm talking about? Something changed. And I knew from my tech background that if you really want to understand something, you measure it. All right, let me like write down, what do I do every day? Let me like keep track, you know, let me actually measure it. If anybody has tried to journal or keep track of their time every day, it's ridiculous. You can't, it's like, it's so hard. So I Googled it and I found this guy, Ben Lipkowitz. This is exactly what I found. He'd been keeping track of his time every day, minute by minute, day after day, for years. And I looked at this, it was like, oh, I love this. Okay, not only, okay, maybe I'm different than you. I thought, not only is it kind of the way I imagine time, forward, backward, but it kind of looked like my stuff. Okay, I mean, he had done this for years. So I didn't hesitate, I scraped it. I downloaded every speck of it, you know, steal like an artist, and started making work based on his time. You know, cut, colored, you know, rose, and I thought his time was really beautiful. It kind of sits at a diagonal. It's almost like he's leaning into the future. He sleeps on a 26-hour clock. It's like he gets a little bit extra out of every day. I thought, that's so unique to him. So specific. But I'm making work out of his time, but it's like, what about me? I thought, okay, I came up with an idea. I can do this. I can figure out how to measure my time while I'm sleeping. I don't have to write anything down. And I got this really accurate EEG monitor. And it turns out waking, sleeping, they're not so different. You're really busy while you sleep. And I got, for the very first time, a chance to see what my data looks like, what my sleep patterns look like. And you think I'm going to tell you it was great. No, I was so disappointed. I was like, ugh. I was really surprised. It just wasn't who I thought I was. I'd always pictured myself this really good sleeper, right? I'm the A student. I'm the good one. I'm the overachiever. And it turns out my sleep is like a C minus. And it just was like, it was almost like an existential crisis. I was kind of crushed. It's like, who am I? And rather than run away, I ended up measuring my sleep for 3 years. I had like 1,000 nights of sleep I measured, but I didn't want to be the only one that was wearing this thing on my forehead every night. And so I got one for my husband. And he goes, he's here. Yes. Okay, I'll do this. But just you wait. I'm a terrible sleeper. Well, it turns out, he's an amazing sleeper. Swings wildly, most of the time. Some of the time, bad. Most of the time, great. But he only remembers the bad. And I thought, oh, that's so him. What if these things can kind of measure your personality? So I scooped up all of this data and started coming up with kind of like an artist algorithm. I came up with rules. Deep sleep, REM sleep, light sleep, they're all color-coded. Light sleep, turns out, is trash sleep. It doesn't do anything for you. I folded it up out of the way and kept making pieces, you know, cut, pasted, glued. I made a whole bunch of these and put it in a show in Los Angeles, in a gallery show called Sleep Patterns. It got a ton of press. It was like, wow, the company that made the little sleep device, they found me, Lori. Hi, what can we do to help you? I get this email, it's like, oh my God, what should I ask for? And I decided, now you know me better, I asked for more data. And I got a chance for the very first time to see my data compared to others. So each one of these blocks is about a month of sleep. Right, each one is each horizontal band is a night of sleep. It's based on how many hours. The purple is the really good stuff, and the orange is when you're waking up. So take a look at the woman, she's 26, right? Really compact sleep, great, look at all that purple, amazing. Who is she? I mean, she's fabulous. And look at the guy, the 47-year-old next to her, he's sleeping a lot, and he's waking up constantly. It's just like, oh. But these were so, you know, you can see right away, these are so individual. They're so specific to each person. They're so identifiable. It's almost like they're a fingerprint. like a portrait, like a data portrait. And I started to think of these, maybe this is like a new type of data selfie. I thought, okay, that's good. I'm on to something. And I decide I'm gonna measure everything. And you'd be surprised how many gadgets you can use. So I decide to use myself for research and really live in the future. What's it gonna be like when you can measure everything and everything about you is known? And I thought, you know, I'll just notice everything. And it's kind of what an artist does. You take the world that you care about and you try to explain it to others. And I kind of have this other fantasy, because I'm so interested in tech and science, and that sometimes artists can, if you really notice and you see something real, that it gets proven by real science. But later, it actually becomes absolutely real. I thought, okay, I'm gonna take this really seriously and measure, you know, and really measure myself and watch and notice patterns in the data. And the thing that I kept looking for were things that were kind of unconscious patterns, getting at that inner sense of self, like who are you, like the proportions of you that you don't even notice or think about that you can measure. It's almost like a neural Fibonacci. We tend to cluster. We go the same places. We repeat ourselves. We like routine. And after a bit, I kind of gave up on cause and effect. You know, this leads to that, because humans are really noisy data objects. And I started to just fixate on what would these patterns, you know, feel like if they were large scale? What if they were in the rooms that we live? What if they surrounded us on the walls like bumpy texture? You know, what if they're, you know, like ambient data? Maybe they could be 3D printed, biofabricated. Right? You get new data, you just like spray them down, whoosh, they dissolve, it's bacterial cellulose, right? I just grow new ones. Or, you know, maybe I move to a new apartment and I just fold it up and recycle it in the new place, I unfold a new one. And so after months, my studio was filled with these cut and drawn patterns of me. And right, I'm really paying attention and I thought, these feel real. They feel human. They feel organic. They feel like me. They were soothing. They resonated. I thought, well, maybe that's the whole point. Maybe patterns are a way to see yourself, your data, as art. Because art makes data sticky. It gets you to look longer. It holds you. It carries emotion. You know, humans are pattern recognition machines. You know, numbers are really abstract concepts, but we understand pattern intuitively. We feed on pattern. And so maybe that's what happens. In the future, it's your data, abstracted as pattern, and played back to you as art. And I find a way to get all my data and understand who I can be. You know, once I was at an artist residency, these places where you go stay in cottages out in the woods, and we're sitting around late at night, we're drinking, and we decide to psychoanalyze each other based on the work that we make, which, that works for everybody. Essentially works. And one of the other artists looks at me and says, Laura, you're wearing a Fitbit. You've got this watch that keeps track of your skin temperature. You're peeing on a strip. You're trying to figure out who you are. It's like, but I think we're all hunting to try to understand who we are. It's so hard to see yourself. Get a new job, you move to a new city, you get a new apartment, you get a new boyfriend. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. But you don't know in advance. You can't see yourself in that way. I mean, you just don't know until you experience things. The idea that you somehow know yourself is just, it's so hard. Think about all this data that's gathered about us, and it feels like it's just so much more than just about advertising. I think data, our data, is about identity. Who am I? So what if it turns out that all this data, all this technology, turns out it's a shortcut to mindfulness. It's a way to boost our, right, our whole immune system. Because maybe your brain can't tell the difference between meditative self-reflection or the intake of a data selfie. It's a good idea, right? But if my idea about art and data doesn't convince you that data could be irresistible, I think overcoming this feeling of powerlessness, 91% of us feel like we've lost control of our data. 85% of us feel uncomfortable with what's measured or tracked about us. But 66% of us have given up. We've thrown in the towel. I'm getting tracked. I worry about what you're doing with it, and all I'm getting is some lousy ads. I want my data. What if we could take back our data? What if we could reclaim it? It's not about getting paid for it. It's about overcoming the opacity. It's just so one-sided. If my data is so valuable, why don't I get to see it? I want my data. Not the easy stuff that I can download, but it's what the algorithms predict about me. I want my data. You know, I see a future where companies are pressured to make it two-way. You measure me, you track me, I get access to it. I want my data. So I look at this current uproar, right, all this data, and I think it's gonna cause companies to like really lock down the raw data that they hold about us. I think this is gonna be hard. You know, and I've asked companies, and they'll say like, how would we possibly supply it to you? Or if we gave you your data, what would you do with it? And I actually think it's easier than that. I actually think it's pretty simple. I think social pressure will coerce companies to share data back with us, encrypted, private. And I think an ecosystem of apps would let us play with it. So for 99 cents, I could take a look at what my mood looks like against my credit card spending. Or you could see all the places you go, you know, superimposed with all of your friends. But what if in the future, it's, you know, art becomes, well, becomes data. What if data becomes art? What if data becomes art in the spaces that we live? And the bonus is to your immune system. I want my data. I want what I dreamed as a little kid, to be able to see into the future and understand who I could become. I think data is irresistibly powerful to human understanding. I want my data. Take back your data. So take back your data and turn it into art.